Got Lee Zavitz here today because I wanted to borrow his camera. I thought it'd be fun to do a sort of throwback lab test video.
This is my Canon 5D Mark II. It was a game changer back in 2008 because no camera at the time that I am aware of could shoot full frame 1080p video. So,
in a little package too, like it's
I don't think they intended this to be a hybrid camera, but it became one.
Right.
It was kind of like the start.
And I remember a lot of the coverage back then. It was like, it's full frame, so shallow depth of field, photo lenses, the democratization of the fact you could use photo lenses out of all this crazy glass, 1080p, small. We were talking about different things we remember being shot on it, and we both remember that house episode where there was like a collapsed tunnel, and they were like, how are we going to get our gear in here to film this thing? And they filmed the whole thing on these little 5D Mark IIs crammed in the tunnel.
It's crazy because it never shot log. It was 8-bit.
So that's why I was interested. I thought, you know, we do all these lab tests here. We're like, this camera can do this many stops, this much rolling shutter. And I was like, what? Where was the starting point, if you will, of DSLR, hybrid, whatever, video? What was the starting point?
You want to talk about Magic Lantern? Someone found a way to hack this camera and put like a parallel operating system that runs off the card. But it gives this camera like a whole new life. Like, the main reason why I installed it was because I wanted focus peaking, because the camera doesn't have focus peaking. But with that, it brought like audio levels, waveforms, zebras, and then later on raw video. So we did some tests in raw video, and it's actually 14-bit raw.
Yeah, it is.
Right off the sensor. So,
and there's a whole bunch of extra information display too, like temperature, bit rate, like things that Canon would have never given you that information.
Canon's UI would have just been like that, right? You don't really see a whole lot. There's so much stuff in here.
Yeah, along the top, every one of those is a different page on the top there.
So you have to use this to scroll that. So you can see down here, we have our raw video.
And we're shooting just below 1080p. It's like 1856 or whatever, pretty much 1080p raw.
But you can go in there and then also change all of your raw settings too, right? So
aspect ratio, bit depth.
You could shoot like your cinematic 239 or whatever.
Magic Lantern's dope.
Yeah.
It can be buggy at times, a little bit crashy sometimes.
Right.
But the capabilities, like we've been making jokes, not even 2008. 10 years later, we were still like, hey, Canon, can we have a exposure tool or something?
Right.
You know? So it's wild that all that stuff was in there.
Mm-hmm.
And it gave us some different things to test, because obviously without that, you're just shooting Canon standard H.264, 1080p. You said it didn't even have 24 frames a second originally.
Yeah, so when it first came out, it was only 30 frames per second in a firmware update, because people were like, we want cinematic 24 frames. And they may have done it just because the movie started wanting to use it.
Right.
So they were probably like, okay, we'll give it 24 frames per second. But like the whole menu to change that, I didn't even show that. But like just to change that, because they didn't have a movie option
in the menu. Yeah, there's no video menu in the menu.
It's literally, I think, live view function setting. And then in there, you can see it.
And you don't even notice it at first in that menu either. You're in like some yellow menu. That's silly. Should we get into some test results?
Yeah, let's take a look at these tests.
Okay. So we've got dynamic range, rolling shutter, and color. So if you don't know how I test dynamic range, I have a chart called the Zali 21 that has 21 stops of dimmer and dimmer light chips. And we film that. And then there's software that measures the noise levels and tries to give you a score of dynamic range. If you have seen my dynamic range test before and you look at this, you're going to go, ouch, because this is what your standard kind of straight at a camera looks like. And I would say 10 to 12 stops just are black.
Yeah, visually it stops at 8.
With Magic Lantern, we were able to do some extra stuff with that.
Yeah.
Magic Lantern, if you shoot raw and you export it as like a log, or you can even convert it to like Blackmagic Design Film and stuff like that. Obviously, there's more information there. Yep. You can see it just appears out of nowhere.
More.
These are IMATEST results. This is where we get the score at the top. It'll say what we shot, H.264 standard. This is just Canon standard. And then usually over here, slope-based DR, that's how many stops, how many patches the camera's able to detect. And then normally we would look at these values to determine how noisy those stops are.
Yep.
Aiming for 0.5 medium to give us a signal noise ratio of 2, that would be good, clean stops. However, you'll notice it says undefined. And that's because if you look at the way that the noise is being interpreted by IMATEST, this is crazy. You don't want them to look like this. You want them to be a clean line. In the camera, you can't control noise reduction and stuff like that with the base software. So it's just, on the camera, it shows zero data. It's a 0%. Like it's just black. You can see there's 11 stops total detected, which it says. On the high, which is like quite clean, 8.8, total 11. That's your operating zone if you shoot Canon standard. Now, if we look at the raw sensor, which is an option, you shoot these like MLV files when you shoot RAW, right, with Magic Lantern. And then there's software, the MLV app. And you can use that to take those files and then export them whatever you want. You could do a Cinema DNG RAW. There's like ProRes 444444 and a bunch of other stuff. If you disable all adjustments and just export it
just the RAW
with nothing on it, this is what you get. It says 14.9 stops, of which that there's a medium score of 9.55. So it's saying about 10 stops are usable. There's 15 stops total, but when you look at that RAW image,
it's so noisy.
Yeah, like you, the noise is insane. It looks like you're shooting at like 50,000 ISO. But now instead, if we export them as known log entities and then try to measure that, there was an option. If you export a Cinema DNG in Resolve, you can develop that as Blackmagic Design film, which is their log.
It's pretty awesome.
And then we get a more conservative 11.6 stops total, where the noise isn't insane anymore.
No, it's definitely usable.
It looks like a normal image.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And if you look at the way the noise is handled down here, the different color is lining up correctly.
Right,
it's not all over the place. And again, still around 10 of a medium. So we're getting some consistency here. We did notice, though, that when you were in Blackmagic Design Film, highlight recovery
is an option. Yeah.
And it actually works. You get, I don't know, half to two-thirds of a stop boost, and you go up to 12 total with a 10.9.
It's almost hitting 11 stops, which is like a pretty...
It's pretty close to like a modern camera, And then we also did one, you could convert it in that MLV app rather than do Cinema DNG. It had some log options itself. We saw that S-Log3 was in there. So, okay, let's convert it as S-Log3 and just export it as that. So now we don't have to develop it. And similar, again, 12 stops total, 10 stops usable. So I feel comfortable in saying that if you have Magic Lantern, you can probably get 10 clean stops out of this camera without much in the way of gimmicks.
Which is pretty damn impressive.
It is.
When you think about all they did was like put a new operating system. And the operating system doesn't even run on the camera. It runs off the card. So you're not like voiding Canon's warranty or anything, right?
Totally.
Yeah.
If you want to see those waveforms we were talking about, here was the S-Log3 waveform. You can definitely see the extra stops now and you can see the noise floor.
Yep.
If we switch to Blackmagic Design, it's just a different curve. Lower noise, but a deeper curve as far as plunging.
Yep.
But if you look at this stop here, which is always clipped when I do a Xyla 21 test. Normally, I try to have this one almost clipped too, but it is still tricky to expose perfectly on this camera because even with the extra tools, you're working on an old little LCD and the waveform and stuff. So we did the best we could. But watch what happens when we check off the highlight recovery box. That stop just comes back.
That's crazy.
They just rebuild that stop on a 2008 camera or whatever.
Yeah.
You don't even need to shoot on a Blackmagic whatever, you know, and it's able to do it. That's wild. Rolling shutter.
Which I was assuming would be in this area.
You nailed it.
Because based off like my experience shooting with this camera back in the day, like it wasn't great. It didn't have the best rolling shutter performance, but the cameras that came after it that I started using, like A7S1 and then into like A6300.
Nothing had good rolling shutter, thinking back, you know.
A7III, like they were all... They all kind of felt the same.
Fair.
Yeah.
Which, for if we put a number on it, that's around 25 milliseconds. A7 IV, which we're shooting this video on, is like a 26, 27 millisecond camera. If I was reviewing a new camera today, I would say 25 milliseconds is pretty slow.
Right.
You know, that's not great.
Right.
But it's hard to knock a 2008 camera for doing 25 milliseconds when I'm shooting on a new camera that's doing 25 milliseconds. You know?
Now, we should say that's 1080p. The new cameras are doing that in 4K.
Okay, no, that's a good point. And they're reading out 7K sensors. So to excuse the A7 IV, it's a 7K read down to 4K, oversampled.
Right.
And then 26, whatever milliseconds. This is 1080p. Okay, yes.
We could upscale this and add some sharpening. Because the RAW, actually, I don't know if you have the example. Or maybe we should just put this on and show the difference.
Oh, we should totally shoot. Yeah, we'll shoot a test.
Yeah, to show the RAW how much, like... more detailed has versus the just straight 1080p.
100%. I'll show those color samples and then we'll do a practical one too. This was extracted from basically Canon standard H.264
1080p. Straight out of camera standard picture.
And when we were looking at it, we're like, oh, did we miss focus? And then we did it again and again. It's like, no, it's just crazily like over sharpened.
But soft.
It's soft because it's like innately soft. And then they crank the sharpness up to make you seem like you have a really sharp image, but it just looks terrible. And you can't turn that off.
One thing I forgot to mention to you too, like you can see the moire and the thing there. This camera was also bad for that, but they made a anti-aliasing filter you could throw in behind the mirror box.
Nice.
Like you'd flip the mirror up and put this like anti-aliasing filter, but it'd just be softer, way softer than that.
You know what though? I'm looking at it. It's not terrible. It's not terrible. It does have the Canon bias a little bit where it tends to be, it pinks up the skin a little bit, gives you that sort of glow, which will look different. If they're looking at this photo, they look at the Sony camera, it's going to look different. But here's two things. And if you want to see the vector scope of that, it looks like this. It's actually reasonably accurate in most of the colorways, but you get this typical lean toward the red on Canon. But then check out this image, which is the RAW.
Yep.
We shot the RAW. We didn't do anything fancy with it. We just exported as a Cinema DNG. But
just
the
Rec 709, right?
Rec 709. Yep. But we noticed that either Magic Lantern or the app or somewhere in the pipeline, they've done color calibration because, first of all...
You should have heard his reaction when he saw this.
I'm a bit of a geek when it comes to like vector scopes and color stuff. I was like, that's perfect. The color is perfect.
You're like, what?
What? But also, the sharpening is gone.
Yeah.
It's actually a much nicer image overall. It has a nicer look to it. Cleaner. The grain,
it's like a nice film.
The noise looks, it looks nicer. It's not blotched out. But check out this vector scope. If anybody out there understands a vector scope, it's like a perfect hexagon. And like, we did nothing. It was shoot, export, the little conversion, and then this is just what came out. Yeah. Look at this skin tone line. We didn't touch anything. This line is like a laser beam that tracks the skin tone line. All the dots are perfect. The red channel is like, it is perfect color.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
And it also deals with the sharpness and everything else.
Yeah, it just looks.
This is a good image.
It looks like how cameras look now, basically.
It does.
Yeah.
That's a good image right there.
Yeah.
And if you're still not happy with the look of this footage of a bozo holding a color chart, you can download better clips of people holding charts of all different types on Storyblocks, the sponsor of today's video, a stock media platform that offers unlimited downloads of diverse and high-quality content for one predictable subscription cost. And Storyblocks offers a whole lot more than just clips of arbitrary bar graphs. In fact, their library houses over 1 million HD and 4K video files, images, and motion graphics templates. And jokes aside, those motion graphics have actually saved me time on previous projects, especially now that they added DaVinci Resolve templates, much better than my previous and tedious method of making those graphics in Photoshop and then animating them in the Edit tab using keyframes. Plus, anything you download from Storyblocks is 100% royalty-free with clear-cut licensing, so you can focus on creating, not worrying about usage rights. The platform is incredibly easy to use, and the library is frequently restocked with commissioned content based on customer demand to ensure you'll have access to files that are not only high quality, but fresh and diverse. So to get started with unlimited stock media downloads at one set price, head to storyblocks.com/undone or click the link in the description. We can't see ourselves.
Right. Yeah, we can't see ourselves because there was no flip-up screen, but we're shooting in 14-bit RAW right now.
And excuse the framing for two reasons. Yes. One, we just wedged it beside the other camera.
Yeah.
And we just have what we have, which was a 50 mil.
Yeah.
So this is what it looks like.
It's not the best lens. It's just the kit lens. Well, I guess it's not a kit lens. It's the nifty 50, but the newest one with the STM motors.
Right.
But
trying to sell affiliate links to a lens or something. So what are we shooting? We're shooting RAW.
Yep.
14. So we'll do that same process where we do the RAW to the no funny business, just straight export with the perfect color and all that kind of stuff. That's what we'll do here.
Put no LUT on it or anything. Yeah. Just straight up the way it is.
Straight out of Magic Lantern.
Straight out of Magic Lantern. I think the issue was the card's not fast enough to keep up with it.
Oh, eventually it drops, yeah.
That's why I was shooting 239 instead of 16:9 because it crops
less
in
vertical
frames.
Resolution made it sustainable.
Yeah, it made it just roll forever. We're trying to figure out what these cameras cost now. And it's like $300. I don't know if I would recommend anyone to buy this as like a starter camera.
It would just be for fun.
I mean, you use it for photography. It's actually a sick camera. Like, still takes amazing photos. Definitely fun to see like what it's capable of, because back when I bought it, I didn't care about any of this stuff. I was just like, this is the best camera. This is the most professional camera I can buy.
I thought it was going to be 20 to 30% worse. I really did.
Yeah. It's still 1080p.
That's so true.
That's
that RAW image isn't bad though.
Yeah,
it's
not
bad.
Yeah.
All right. End of video.
I'm done.